setting for the program I think of is comes from the King James translation of Psalm 24, the first verse. The earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof, the world and they that dwell therein. Well, today our speakers will address, one, that fullness, and secondly, what affects those of us who dwell therein. The program includes a bit of background statement for each one of our speakers, but I'd like to give you two additional facts about Dr. Kenneth Taylor. He is the 13th person to hold the position as the State Geologist of North Carolina. That position was established 190 years ago. It's a long-standing tradition. One other thing of note to North Carolinians is that before he became director, State Geologist and Director of the Geological Survey, he had been Director of the Office of Emergency Management. And in that position, he received an award from the Undersecretary of the U.S. Department of Homeland Security for the implementation of a program called, an acronym, H-A-Z-U-S, HAZUS, HAZUS. It's a program that estimates the consequences of the effect on the structure, what should we call it, the social well-being, the economics, and the physical damage to portions of the state as a consequence of any one of four major disasters, such as riverine flooding, coastal flooding, hurricanes, and earthquakes. And now I would like to present to you Dr. Kenneth Taylor.
Our job was to find the resources, to document the mineral resources of the state, and to put that out in publications and maps. We are the first state ever to produce a statewide geologic map that was produced and given to the General Assembly in 1825. That map is our very first geological map of the whole state in our nation. The key thing about it was is that one of the things that was in that map was the plumbagos of Wake. Well, plumbago, people think about that's lead. Well, there were lead deposits inside of Wake County. It wasn't lead like a lead acid battery, it was graphite. And one of the stories about that is when they made the pencils, because remember, you're at a time when you're still using quill pens. And now you go and say there's new technology that even in the rain you can write on stuff and have no problem. So one of the critical issues about it was that a bundle of them were sent by the governor of North Carolina up to Washington, D.C. to move this down a little bit, to give our president a chance to see this new technology. Well, the president had a good friend of his. He was from New York, and that guy said, those same kind of rocks are in my home state. Anybody know what town that is? They're still making them today. Ticonderoga. Now, one of the key things we look at there and see is we are statutorily required to provide unbiased, technically accurate information to all parties. Don't come in as an advocate for one side or another. So part of the thing we're doing right now is talking with you about what we've done from our research on oil and gas. This map here shows there's various kinds of oil and gas. They start off in two flavors. One flavor is called conventional. These are the ones you hear about in Texas and other places where the rock is cooked, it moves up into a porous layer that has a lot of interconnectivity, and you have your oil and gas move up to where it gets trapped in like a dome on the left side or a stratigraphic track on the right side, and then you drill down into that vertically and can then remove that oil or gas. That's called conventional. For a long time, we knew that there was another kind of oil and gas called unconventional. The unconventional means it came out of a shale rock that has almost no permeability. It has no interconnectivity. It's got lots of space to put the little molecules of methane or oil, but they can't connect and get out. So when I was a student, we went up to the Marcellus, we went up to the other units that were the shale units, and the professors would say, take a chunk of that rock. What's it smell like to you? And it smells like oil. But at the time I was a student, in the late 70s, early 80s, there's no use for it. We cannot find a technology to get the oil and or gas out. Now, when you go and cook the rock to generate oil and gas, you start off being in an immature side, like I have on the left side of the diagram. That immature is basically, it hasn't been cooked long enough. As you cook it longer, and you look at the temperatures down there at 400 degrees, 425 degrees, 450 degrees C, that's degrees centigrade. It's sort of like cooking a very, very fancy kind of spaghetti sauce. It takes time to mature. It'll go from the immature to the oil gas, oil window. It will then go into the condensate, where the big molecules of petroleum are broken down into smaller molecules that are the condensates, like butane, propane, ethane. And then finally moves on over where those molecules themselves are broken down into just plain methane, CH4, and you have dry gas. Now, these curves here are from 5 wells in North Carolina. So you see it goes all the way over. If you look at the one that's in the orange there, sorry, on the side there, look at the one in orange, you'll see that it's going completely from the immature straight through to the oil window, straight through into the condensate window, straight through into the over-mature, just dry gas, and then back again. And that's because that one well that was drilled, Thumb and Palmer, was a very shallow coal bed methane well, and it was also intruded by a dye-based dike. And that dye-based dike had cooked the rocks even more in that intrusion, and it created that unique opportunity to see how you go through that oil and gas window. Now, conventional exploration in North Carolina is very simple and very straightforward. 128 wells have been drilled in North Carolina since 1925. First one was drilled in Carteret County. You look at there and see, this is S.O. Hatteras Well. Yeah, notice you see the lighthouse, you see the mud pit there. Well, here we show on the left side, on the right side, there's a close-up of where the Hatteras light well was and where it was being moved to when it was backed up from the shoreline. So it basically got moved back to where the mud pit used to be for the 1946 well. So this was conventional. They drilled this down, went down the deepest well in the entire East Coast, 10,000 feet. They got nothing. No oil, no gas. Well, how many of you have seen the movie with Daniel Day-Lewis, Let There Be Blood, about the Texas oil fields and stuff like that? If you're Exxon, or this time it was Esso, you do not want to have a major incident on the first well drilled after World War II on the East Coast. So you put extra mud in the well and make sure nothing comes out of the well. We have cores from that well that were given to us by the company. And we have them, and we can go back and look at them, and we can scrape off that mud, and there's actual oil and gas in that well. Later on, Pamlico Sound. That's a boat. Could you see the seaplane tender next to it? They're drilling through the Pamlico Sound for this well here. They drilled down 6,000 feet. Once again, no shows of oil and gas. So many people said, hey, there's no problem. Totals, we had 128 wells drilled. 126 of those were plug and abandoned. When you plug and abandon the well, it means you're not going to use it anymore. You then fill it full of cement. You then cut it off 3 feet below the surface. And you put a steel cap on top of it. And you put on that steel cap what the name and location of the well is. So if someone digs it up again, they can find it. So 126 wells were drilled, except for these two there, Butler and Simpson. 124 of those have been plug and abandoned. Last well we had drilled was in 1998. We have not received money from the General Assembly to go out and do oil and gas exploration. That's not our purpose. That's what a private company does. We may do some test drilling to get more information, but we are not in the authorized oil and gas business. Our top five counties, Onslow is the biggest one with 22. Carteret and Brunswick both tied with 16, and Dare has 15, and Hyde has 10. So there's lots of it being punched down, and nothing was ever found. You look at there and see is that by year, you'll see that 1971 was the hot year for the geological survey. At that time, the state geologist was a guy named Steve Conrad. Steve Conrad had a staff of four people, and him made five. They had to be the persons observing all the major activities on all 19 of these wells. As Steve told me, that was the year we didn't do anything except run around the countryside. Now, once again, we're going back to the thing again, and now we're going to talk about the continuous. The continuous ion conventional, that's where the hydrocarbons have been cooked, but they can't get out of the rock. You're creating petroleum, you're creating natural gas inside the rock, but it can't get out. So you have to find some way to go in there and break pathways for it to be able to get out. So what they've done is they do hydraulic fracturing. A long time ago, they used, in the late 80s and 90s, they used nitrogen foam, for example. Liquid nitrogen was what was used. The Canadians use propane today. Remember, things in Canada get cold real quick for a large chunk of the year, so they can't use water. They have to use something that doesn't freeze. So they use propane. The propane just comes back out of the ground as a condensate. It's a product. So they just frack it with propane, and then it comes back up, and that just becomes part of their resource they're now selling from their wells. The reason why they drill horizontally is because if you have a layer of, let's say, 200 feet of rock that's very much the prospective source, you're only going to get 200 feet of exposure to be able to get stuff out of it if it's drilled vertically. But if it's drilled horizontally, you'll have thousands of feet if you want to get that resource out. And that's why they do that hydraulic fracturing. Now, this is what my job has been for the last 2.5, almost 3 years. I am on the Mining and Energy Commission as a person writing the rules for them for our modern oil and gas program, and I'm ex officio. That means I'm on there because they told me to be on there. They did not ask somebody to nominate me to be a member of a commission. I was assigned to all three of the major committees, our Environmental Standards Committee that looked on how we're going to do things to protect the environment. We were on our Water and Waste Management Committee, how we're going to deal with the waste. I was also on the Committee for the Administration of Oil and Gas. So last year, I went to 48 Mining Energy Commission meetings in just 1 year. Either committees, full commissions, study groups, or other activities associated with the job. I was tasked many times to do reports. So, for example, one of the first things I had when the commission was formed up was there were three of us that were geologists. One had been a former oil and gas guy, one had been a mining geologist, and myself. So the first thing I was tasked to do was, please explain how other states do this. So I went up there and got some interns, we got data files, and we got them and said, here's what the application process is in Texas. Here's what the application process is in Ohio. This is the process that's used in Arkansas. Just to give them a baseline of knowing what was there. In Texas, they have 57 different permits to apply for. If you want to do something, you have to get a permit. And so it's always a cash thing, you know, ka-ching, ka-ching, ka-ching. In Pennsylvania, when they started doing laterals, they had 29 permits the first day. They then had 28 or 27 the next day. And then the following Monday, they had about the same number. You know, the number one person they hired immediately in the oil and gas program in Pennsylvania was a cashier. Because each permit was worth $900 to $1,400 a piece, and they had a requirement to put the check in the bank and cash it within 24 hours of them receiving it. So everybody made a run for the bank Friday afternoon at 4 o'clock to get the checks in. One of the toughest problems about it was the state of Pennsylvania had by rule that it took approximately 48 hours of review to review an oil and gas permit. So they had a requirement, you had to do it within 48 hours. That's not 48 24-hour days, that's 48 hours being six business days. But when you get 26 the first or 29 the first day, and about the same for the next 2 days, and there's only two people doing the reviews, all of a sudden you see that there's a real problem. The state of Pennsylvania has now moved out their time for an individual permit out to 45 to 50 days. That's more realistic to see what has to be done during that period of time. The hydraulic fracturing by volume and process, we had study groups. One of the study groups was impact on local governments, how much traffic we're going to have on the roads. And the whole thing was is that we start from the reality of saying, this is how many gallons of water will be needed. Then you can work back and say how many truckloads will be necessary for that, and then confirm the information with other states. We also look at there and saw the modeling of severance tax, because the General Assembly wanted to know how much money we're going to make out of this. Right. And so we gave them numbers and gave them scenarios of different levels of funding. Also, I was assigned to do a coordinating permitting. When we got up there and started, they wanted to have the General Assembly wanted one division in Diener, not five, one, to be in charge of oil and gas issues. Well, we got ready, we started putting that study group report together, and we discovered that inside the division, which I'm part of, we're the problem. Because we have two separate programs that have the independent authority to do separately different things. And we had to coordinate that where it didn't fit underneath our division doing all that activity. And it was not another division of our department, whether it be water quality or water resources, for example. I was also tasked to be the hearing officer for these things. We have to have, by law, one public hearing on our set of rules. Because a lot of times, for environmental rules, there really aren't any controversies. We went and had four. One in Raleigh, one in Sanford, one in the Dan River Basin, and one out in Western North Carolina. They all were 3 hours long, and we got comments. Lots and lots and lots and lots of comments. 218,285 comments were received during the 60-day period of time when we had our permit, our information out there in the public. Now, except for one of the hearing officers and myself, we're the only two that read every single one of those comments. We know we did because we had to edit and say what the response for those comments were. Now, the reason why I was picked to do that was because I had previous experience in doing public hearings. I know how to run them for mining permits for years. I've been doing that for my division for going on now about 10 years. Now, this is the lag you have from a well. The well goes down, the well goes out laterally. There's multiple layers of defense. There's conductor casing at the very top. that's cemented in. There's surface casing that goes from the surface all the way down to below the water table. And that's cemented in. And then there's intermediate or production casing that goes out all the way down to the actual using layer where you're looking at getting information and trying to get your resource out. Now, when we had the vote on that, I was leading the crew that said we want to cement everything in from top to bottom. Conductor, surface, intermediate, and final production casing. There are 15 members of the commission. We did not win that vote. When I was sitting in there as a hearing officer with the two other people that I was hearing officer with, one of the things we were required as our number one ground rule was, we're not going to fight a battle again that you lost. So we're not going to get up there and say, oh, as a hearing officer, we believe we need to change this rule because it's now not convenient for you or someone, one of the other hearing officers to say, we're going to change the rules now so it fits my thing I lost on. Now, the hydraulic processing, it basically starts with perforation. When you go down that pipe, you're going to send in a perforation gun. A perforation gun is basically loaded with 50 caliber machine gun bullets and demolition cord. It goes down in the ground, and then you ignite it. It shoots those bullets into the steel and into the cement and into the mother rock. And that creates a potential pathway for the gas and oil to come out. There will be between 25 and 35 shots being done on each perforation run. You start at the very end of the lateral and work your way back up. Because if you start right at the pipe where it turns and you make a mistake and the well collapses, you lost out on all that money. You will spend millions of dollars. So you start at the end and work your way back up. Next is isolation. You put in a packer. A packer is a big rubberized plug. So then you can put water in there or whatever you're using to expand the fractures and get the fractures to enlarge. You start pumping large volumes. I'm going to show you how much volumes you're talking about here. The pumping is there, followed by increasing the pressure. You kick up the pressure higher and higher and higher and higher. Finally, the cracks will actually break. When the cracks break, the pressure then goes back down because some of that water has leaked out into that formation. So you bring the pressure back up in order to get the fractures to increase in length. Once you get a fracture there, what you do is pump in very fine sand. It's called proppant. The proppant's used to hold the fractures open. You pump in very, very fine sand first, then less fine sand, then coarser sand in as you go back from the very tips of the fracture all the way back to right next to the hole. And then finally reduce the pressure, and when you reduce the pressure, the rock collapses in on, and the little balls of fine sand hold the fracture open. And you've had a successful fracture. You then back everything back up, and start from the packer you just put in, close it off completely, and then start the next sequence of doing perforation gun comes in, and you start back up a step number one and go right through. Now, here's a water use example. This is one that was done in December of 2012. And this gives you an example. You're talking about it being, 43,000 barrels of fresh water and 49,000 barrels of recycled water. Let's convert that from barrels into gallons. And that's basically 3.9 million gallons of water. 1.8 million of that, or 47% of that, is fresh water. The rest of it you see in there, it says recycled water. In Arkansas, they have made a very good program of setting up an ability to take the salts out of the water and recycle that and use it again. The water that comes out of our rocks is not that salty. So therefore, we look at there to be recycled it right on the spot. In addition, you have here, this is the same completion report, but it lists by volume stuff that's in there. You're look at there and see the proppant is about 5% of the volume, and everything else is then parts of 1% of the volume. But you add in hydrochloric acid, and that when you're adding 8,000 gallons of hydrochloric acid out of a volume of 3 million gallons of water and 800,000 pounds of sand, this is about a 4,000, this was about a 4,000 foot lateral that was done. And it was done in 7 or 8, go back one here. It was done in 9 stages. It will be done over a period of days. But you look in there and see all the other chemicals are added. You have on there sand, you have on there water, you have on there ethylene glycol, which is a friction reducer. You use that every day. It's radiator fluid. It makes the water go in the radiator and the engine quickly so it can cool down faster. But also I have a thing down there at the bottom. See, it says trade secret, Southwest Well Services, and it is a amino polycarbolic salt. Well, one of the tasks I've been given by the General Assembly is I'm the keeper of the trade secrets. If somebody wants to say, I claim a trade secret, you have to tell me what the chemical classification the material is. You don't have to tell me the actual formula, you tell me what class it belongs to. Well, look up amino polycarbolic salt. Do a Google search and I can get to the Stephanie Davis sheet in like 3 minutes. So this is the kind of information I can give to the emergency responders immediately. We have in our rules 3 important things dealing with chemicals. 30 days before you even show up at the site, you have to tell me every single chemical you're using on the site. If you are claiming a trade secret exemption, you have to tell me at that time, I want an exemption on this chemical. Fine, tell me the chemical class. You don't get to say no. You have to tell me the chemical class, that's what the law says. I then use whatever technique I can use to find out about that chemical class. Nextly, is the emergency managers get all that information the same time I do. State emergency management has to secure that information because they have to use it for planning purposes. If we have an incident and they say, we would like to release this, a doctor or a fire chief says, I want to release this information, we're treating patients or responding to an emergency, you get it right there. But you have to call and say, we need it right now. These are the bases in North Carolina. We have one base that runs from basically Granville County all the way down to the South Carolina line. This is the Deep River Basin. We know a lot of information about the sub-basin called Lee Sub-Basin in Lee County. There's also the Dan River Basin, too, up in Stokes and in Rockingham counties. What happened was a long time ago in geologic time, the continent began to break apart, and there was a series of rift basins, very much like you have in the East African Rift, a narrow, very deep hole. And that was where organic matter was accumulating very rapidly. If the organic matter can be buried rapidly, it doesn't rot. And therefore, those organic molecules can be turned into oil and gas. The Deep River Basin is about 150 miles long, 7,000 feet of Triassic sediment. The particular area we're looking at is about between 400 and 100 feet thick. It's got all the things necessary for it to be a real resource. This is what it looks like on a geological cross-section, a slice through the earth. The Cumnock Formation is the one that's marked there in gray. That Cumnock Formation is an organic rich shale. That's in between two sandstones, sandstone above and sandstone below. Now, this map is very busy, but what it has is the geology down at the bottom. This was from Reinemann's work done in 1955. It also has the seismic lines that were done. It also has all the wells that were done in there. So, including the coal holes that were drilled by Reinemann back in the World War II era, we have 44 data points within this basin. This is why the U.S. Geological Survey thought it was, we have enough data for doing an assessment. And what the USGS did was basically said, look at these things like these seismic lines. You have Bobby Hall's well cut in there, and you have the exact location where the Cumlock Formation is found. We have actual cores to look at. We have other places there that show us clearly where the rock is. So the key thing was is you've got to have three things to play. You've got to have organic rich material, over 1.4%. That's all you need to start the generation of oil and gas. Secondly, it's from the right kind of stuff. It's like woody matter or algae. And the final one is it's been cooked long enough to where it's turned into those products. There's many places I can take you where there's organic rich rock. It hasn't been cooked long enough. So there is no oil and gas in it. Or it's been cooked too long and there isn't any oil and gas or any gas in it at all. So the USGS came in and said, hey, they gave us a small grant of about $23,000 to turn all of our data from digital form, sorry, from paper form into digital form, so they could do it as part of a numerical analysis. There were five basins that were identified and looked at. Our Deep River Basin, the Dan River Basin, the Taylorsville and the Culpeper Basin, and then finally the South Newark Basin. These are the only ones that had enough geologic data to say, is it there or not? The rest of them, like the South Georgia Basin is huge, but there's no wells drilled in it. No one's done the exploration work in that area. So the USGS generated a fact sheet. We gave the information in July of 2011. It took them about a year to get the thing processed. And they came out with an estimate. They said basically there's 1,660 billion cubic feet of gas in the Deep River Basin, and about 83 million barrels of natural gas liquids. These were the numbers we used to do the analysis for the General Assembly on what the revenue would be. I'm not in the estimating, you know, that. I mean, yes, the Geological Survey precedes the U.S. Geological Survey by 63 years, but I do not have thousands of people working for me. I have only 12. So I can't take on the USGS and say, oh, I'll tell you how to do this. For the Dan River Basin, it was only a little bit of stuff, a mean of 59 billion cubic feet of gas and no natural gas liquids. That's because we had not yet finished processing the data from the Dan River Basin. The USGS is composed, this assessment team is composed of probably fifth generation Missourians. They did not believe anything we could not prove right there on the spot. It was like going to your PhD oral examination and being grilled for 5 hours by all the professors that have hated everything you ever did. Now, one of the biggest things you'll find out in the shale gas business is when the wells start producing, the wells run out of gas quickly. Even if you start with, for example, 5 million cubic feet per day, by the time 5 years or 6 years has passed, 90% of that gas will be gone. So that means you have to schedule up the next well, the next well, the next well, the next well along the way. So then you'll have a production that runs relatively flat over an extended period of time. So one of the toughest things you find here is that when you look at these sort of situations, this is part of the process, that success with one well will result in another well application within a matter of weeks to drill somewhere else, and another one after that. So we plan in our regulatory environment to be able to have that ramp up quickly ability to be able to have the necessary personnel to get the kind of stuff done. So we're saving the discussion until the end, so I'm finished, and it's time to switch on to my other speaker.
Professor Bengosh gets his computer up and running. Let me add a few comments to his brief biographical statement, which is covered in your program. In 2013, he received the Best Science Paper Award from the Journal Environmental Science and Technology for a paper titled Impacts of Shale Gas Wastewater Disposal in Water Quality in Western Pennsylvania. And more recently, this fall, he received another NSF grant for slightly in excess of $250,000. And currently he is managing, or has managed, almost $8 million worth of grants to continue his work in this field of study. Okay, Avner, ready? Don't forget, when you exit for refreshments, to write your questions on the card and hand it to any one of us on the board. You can identify us with a green name tag on our lapel. Thank you.
Hello, everyone. Thank you for Dave for having me here. And it's a pleasure to be here. So I'm a geochemist. I've been working on water resources for, I don't know, 30 years, trying not to think about that. And being working, I'm from Israel originally, so that's my accent. And I've been working on issues related to water in the Middle East and got a lot of trouble. So when I moved here, I started to work on issues that got me also into trouble, but a different one. I don't know what is more harsh troubles, but in our Duke, so I'm in Duke University at the Nicholas School of Environment, and we are trying to address different issues related to energy and society and how it's been affecting our life. And we've been working on issues related like mountaintop mining in West Virginia, coal ash disposal, which is a big thing for North Carolina, as you know, shale gas and hydraulic fracturing that I'm going to address today, and also we are involved in tar sand studies in Canada. So overall, we are trying to find the link between those different issues and the environment. And we are coming from the scientific tools that we are trying to establish and to understand hydraulic fracturing. And what I will do today in my 30 minutes that I have here, I will try to, first of all, introduce you to a broader sense of hydraulic fracturing in the U.S. to see the big picture. We saw what's going to happen in North Carolina. And we're going to address the big picture, and then I'm going to give some highlight of our research that we've been conducted in this topic for the last 5 years. So, probably you are aware that coal has been the major source of energy in the United States, but now natural gas has become a major source, and here we see kind of the evolution of the different energy sources that have been utilized in the United States. And traditionally, for the last 20, 30 years, coal has been the major source of energy, but now with the rise of hydraulic fracturing and unconventional oil and gas, hydraulic fracturing and natural gas are becoming the leading points. And the future, we see here the different distribution of natural gas and the different other sources. There are some good news and bad news. The bad news, coal is still going to be a major source of energy into projected into the future. Renewable, unfortunately, going to be small as it is today. That is based on the U.S. Energy Information Administration. And natural gas is going to be a major source. And if you look at the electricity itself, when we turn on the light, here in North Carolina, most of our source is coal, but in the rest of the United States, natural gas is going to substitute the coal that we have been using. And there are different steps associated with hydraulic fracturing, and we heard about the process as it happened. From water perspective, and that's what we do, we look at the water, there are several important steps associated. There's the water acquisition, and then there's always the question, do we have enough water? There is the chemical mixing, what we actually put on the shale gas well in order to open the fracture and to make it efficient. And then is the issues which I see one of the most critical is the management of the waste that's coming from hydraulic fracturing. What do we do with the wastewater? And that's a critical aspect. And this is kind of a map of shale gas basin in the United States. And it's all over the United States and increasingly coming now just all around the state. Here we can see that the distinction between in some basin we extract oil, in other we extract gas. And because of the prices of gas, there is a need now for petroleum. And most of the shale gas basins, like in North Dakota, for example, they're looking for oil, for liquid rather than gas. But this is going to change now that the United States is going to build a huge facility for liquidation of the gas and start to export gas as a liquid throughout the world. And this is going to change that gas is going to be as valuable as petroleum into the future. And if we look in kind of the evolution, the turning point was about mid 2000, 2004, 2005, where the rise of exploration took place really exponentially. And right now we're talking about 13-15% of shale gas exploration, which is going to be up to almost half of the natural gas that's going to generate in the United States is going to be from unconventional shale gas exploration into the future. And this has changed dramatically the geopolitical situation in the United States with the international kind of geopolitics. Many of their predictions suggest that the United States is going to be exceeding Saudi Arabia in exporting oil and gas in the next decade. So because of this unconventional oil and gas, we are a very different situation. And some related this also to the changes of the oil prices because of the supply of, at least in domestic level right now in the United States, a supply of petroleum, which has, in addition to geopolitics, other issues, decline, which is a decline of the cost for oil barrel. And the importance of shale gas, that is not only United States, is going to be a global phenomenon very soon. So I'm taking you from North Carolina into the United States, but this is going to be a global phenomenon. In Canada, I mentioned they're already exploring shale oil and shale gas. South America, Northern Africa, South Africa just came back from a visitor. China is having actually doubled the resources estimated for the United States. And when China is going to move into shale gas, they're going to change dramatically the landscape about oil, about the using, right now they're using 80% of the energy is from oil, is from coal, excuse me. So this changing into natural gas would change dramatically air pollution. There's a lot of implication for this kind of a global. There's also implication that Eastern Europe, like Poland, can start to extract oil and gas from hydraulic fracturing and change the dependence on Russia. Some people argue that the invasion into Ukraine was related to resources that in Ukraine have shale formation. So all the geopolitics now turning, all the movies that we saw before is going to change pretty dramatically because of this new resources. But together with that, today the issues of hydraulic fracturing or fracking, if you call it by environmentalists, this is one of the major debate issues. And I'm going to address some of the debate issues about emission of methane to the atmosphere. There's issues about contamination of water, contamination of air, air pollution, wastewater, health implication, infrastructure, roads, noise. It's going to change dramatically the life of the people who have been living, and we know that from since 2005, Pennsylvania people who are living in areas of shale gas exploration. So there are many issues associated with the environmental implication. Some of them are became, I see it as a myth. Some of them are real. And in our research, we're trying to address, to find a balance between what is real and what is not, and trying to understand that. But interestingly, the issues of fracking has become really amazing kind of a movement throughout the United States and overseas. Like traveling in New Zealand, the first sign I see coming off the plane was no fracking in New Zealand, like places that you would not expect to have any issues. So this is a really, I think, after climate change, one of the debated topic that has been captured many environmental and social groups around the world, and also related in very concrete action. For example, New York has just recently banned hydraulic fracturing, high volume hydraulic fracturing with horizontal drilling that you just heard the description. Many communities, different states, different towns as well are following that in different parts of the United States and different countries around the world, France, Romania, all have decided so far to ban and not allow to use hydraulic fracturing. And so the debate is really something that is going on, and again, that's kind of the issues. One of the key things that we found, that I found fascinating coming from a different country, that everything related to wastewater disposal until now, which is really a few days ago, until now the oil and gas development has been exempt from environmental regulation, particularly when we're talking about federal law regarding to the Safe Drinking Water Act. And so therefore, there was no federal control and federal legislation to control what you do with the wastewater. Different states have their own way to deal with it. And as a result, we have very different differential way to different states are dealing with the wastewater that I'm going to talk about, and kind of pretty chaotic situation that's resulted overall, I think, by hurting the industry. And what I'm coming here, I'm not coming to preach anti-fracking, but I think the lack of regulation, this is kind of the bottom point of my talk, is to say the industry hurts itself, is not revealing the information. Everybody really in the industry knows those secret trades, if they really want to know that. But the fact that it's hide from the public, it's actually hurt the industry. The fact that those wastewater are not regulated and there are so many spills and contamination, actually by the end hurts the industry. So I think being more open and transparent actually would help. So at Duke, we started to look at different questions we wanted to address. What does shale gas drilling hydrofracturing causing contamination of water resources? Very basic question. And what are the impacts when we manage the wastewater, how this will affect water resources? And we try to address, can we fix the problem in some way? So this was our approach. And as I said, I've been working on water issues for over 30 years, and one of the tools that we are doing is using fingerprint, not of our people, but actually looking at the water and ask the water where you're coming from. And each of the water on Earth will have a very different chemical and isotopic fingerprint, different DNA characteristic that tell us what's the source, where they're coming from, and how they will spread into the environment. And based on this kind of diagnostic tool, which we developed in the process, we were able to tell when you have contamination and when you don't. So we built kind of a network of research that was funded by NSF and some private institution, including our own School of Environment, that provide the first funding for our study, and to try to find the link between water quality and shale gas exploration. We look at chemistry of the water, we look at different isotopes of the gas, we look at isotopes of the water, and together we look at radionuclide, and together we try to understand the system. We've been working extensively in Pennsylvania, in West Virginia, in Texas, Arkansas, and we did some baseline in North Carolina. And overall, we collected hundreds of private well samples in those different places. We collected hundreds of surface water from different areas that we suspected to be affected by wastewater that coming from the fracking. And we used very large geochemical and isotopic tools to try to understand the system. So one of the kind of the output of our study, which summarized here, we tried to delineate what are the major risks for water resources. And we identified three major risks that we published in a review paper that, by the way, is going to also have the best paper award coming for 2014. So we discovered that water footprint in some places, Texas, the amount of water that you use for hydraulic fracturing could be critical, it could be a limiting factor, and could have a long-term effect. We talked about water contamination. We were able to differentiate between different types of water contamination. Water contamination by gas in a sub-small group, but existing. This is the case when people actually can put the water on fire, when the water becoming super saturated with gas. And there's issues of how to manage the wastewater. And the wastewater is, we have seen, because of the nature of hydraulic fracturing, we have seen that there are numerous of spills and the disposal of what to do with the wastewater, which is a big issue that you're going to address in my talk. So we kind of built a kind of a possible a path, a possible, you see those different arrows trying to reconstruct possible pathways of contaminants, either gas or water that could be leaked from the system. Again, we are not saying that hydraulic fracturing is always can contaminate the environment. But we say we have found many cases that we see a small effect on the environment, and we can tell now by using our different isotope which of those different errors take place, and we can identify that. So the first risk that I would like to highlight is the risk of what we call stray gas contamination. Stray gas contamination is when you have leaks from a well, and it goes into people's private wells, and because of the leaking of the gas, they could put the water on fire. That is, there's not any health risk. You can drink water with methane. We don't think that, we haven't found any study, kind of health-related study about that, but because of the nature of methane, it's really because it poses potential inflammatory and explosion hazard to the house. And in fact, if you're living in a house that exceeding a certain level, this the state, the local state in Pennsylvania, would actually cut off your well because you're not allowed to use this water because of this risk. There's also issues of devaluation of property values because of the gas in the house. And the bank, it's funny, the bank doesn't really do much science. They actually see if there is a gas, they would cut the valuation of those houses. And there are some other issues that we are finding that's a secondary factor which affect the methane oxidation, which cause sulfate reduction, and there is some smell in the house. Now, there is a debate right now among the scientific community. We published several papers that address, to show this potential contamination from shale gas well. In contrast, there were several other papers coming from the industry that dispute our studies. They suggest that all gas that we see in houses are derived from naturally occurring. And they argue that what we are saying is not correct. We published our studies in peer review publication. This is the case where our colleagues, which are not very friendly, trying to evaluate our study and give a comment, and it's many times very hard pass to publish those paper into those journal. But nonetheless, we have demonstrated there is a risk The first paper we published in 2011 in the Presidio National Academy of Science, followed by another paper in 2013 in the Presidio National Academy of Science, and the third one just in last fall in the same journal. And in this journal, in these different studies, we were able to show that a subfraction of wells located less than a kilometer from a shale gas well in Pennsylvania and also in Texas would have higher concentration of methane that is different from well located more than kilometers away from a shale gas site. So we see that there is not only elevated methane, but the methane that are associated with those wells located less than a kilometer, they have a very unique geochemical characteristic, those fingerprints that I was talking. It's not only high methane. High methane is not enough to tell if you have contamination or not, but the chemistry and the isotopic fingerprint that make them very different from the other type of water was the reason why those are coming from mainly of shale as well. We use the chemistry, we use isotopes, and so we found this is the correlation, the special analysis together with the chemistry gave us this tool. Here you can see an example that you actually see the methane bubbles coming out from the sample that we collected just a minute ago. And the last paper that we show with a very sophisticated technique called noble gas, that together with the methane told us really what are the, which of the wells that we examined are actually cause contamination from leaking of the gas, free gas from the well, and which of the wells have natural occurring methane, which we never dispute about that. So basically, based on this combination, we build tools that enable us to distinguish between natural occurring methane and methane that coming from leaking of shale gas well. And this series of studies opened a new research about well integrity. How much wells, and there is now, after full publication of those studies, even voices within the industry claim that shale gas well, even conventional wells are leaking, not only unconventional, which are more the high pressure and the configuration would make it much more vulnerable for leaking of gas. And this is one of the topics that need, if you are living next to a shale gas well, you need to be worried about that, that you don't want to have the methane leaking into your system. The second issue that we have found is surface water contamination associated with the management of the waste. Now we found there is a huge frequency of spills occur in areas of shale gas development in Pennsylvania, and now also in North Dakota that we are, and we have evidence for that. So the issues of the frequency of spill and the issues of what do we do with the wastewater. And that I'm going to show you different issues of the wastewater. One of the problems with the wastewater that they contain radioactive element, natural occurring radioactive element. And when those radioactive elements remove from the pipe into the river, those radioactive elements would absorb and retain within the sediment. And we found that the level of this radioactivity in areas of disposal should be defined as low radioactive waste disposal site because of that huge level of natural occurring radioactivity. So we see that even if we stop all disposal today in those sites, they're already doomed. They're already being contaminated with wastewater, and they're going to say. So there is issues of radioactivity, also issues of, as you know, based in North Carolina, we're drinking the water of the other, for the upstream person. We use the water for different use, including wastewater. Now, having elevated level of salt in the wastewater causing the potential formation of carcinogenic, highly carcinogenic disinfection byproduct in the downstream user. So this is another potential risk that we have been able to identify, all related to the correct management, how to handle the wastewater. And if all we're looking at the example of Pennsylvania, West Virginia, and we see that the lesson we learned from those places we should never adopt in North Carolina. And the wastewater management is the key issue. Now, what is in the wastewater? There are salt, there are high level of toxic element, like ammonium that we discovered recently, barium, arsenic, this radioactive. Those organic matter, actually the man-made chemicals being added to hydraulic fracturing fluid, those secrets level, they are tiny amount, but they are extremely, some of them are benign, some of them are extremely toxic. So the management of this wastewater is critical, and in the US there are different ways to deal with it. Some they discharge it into a brine treatment center in Pennsylvania, which is supposed to take care of the water and release it to the environment. We found that this treatment is insufficient. In some, they are trying to recycle, and indeed recycling is becoming more and more in many of the states. However, the salinity of the water prevents 100% of recycling. So now we're adding that cost of how to get to make this water suitable to be able to use for the further recycling for hydraulic fracturing. Ironically, in New York and in West Virginia, it's legal to take the brine and spread it into roads for de-icing in the winter and dust suppression in the summer. I certainly hope the committee in North Carolina did not adopt this way, because it's one of the worst things you can imagine, taking those brine and putting it directly into the field. Now, there is some ironic in that, because in New York they banned fracking, but they allowed to do that. So, another issue that's happening in most of the United States now, you probably heard about it, is the trigger seismicity, earthquake. Now, earthquake is not related with fracking. There is a myth about that. When we're doing fracking, in most cases, the hydraulic fracturing itself created small seismic events within the formation, and it's not, and the level is very small. There's not any issue. The issue is what to do with the wastewater. And the wastewater, if there is no any fault, geological fault, the wastewater will go to deep aquifer where the water is highly saline, and this is really the clean way to get rid of the wastewater. But if the wastewater is, the well of the wastewater associated with the fault system, there is a terminology called liquidation of the geological fault, and that will trigger an earthquake. And that's what happened to many geological system that were not being active for the last 50 years, and associated with recharge of the wastewater, it's triggered those seismicity which will result in an earthquake. So if what to do? Should we put it into the river, like we did in Pennsylvania, and this is a real case that we studied. And we study all the different chemicals that are actually coming together with the wastewater. We published, this is the paper that Dave mentioned, that, this is a different paper we published this year. We found high bromide, high iodine, high ammonium. And this is, for me, it was unbelievable because, you know, wastewater is very well regulated. So if we have a 1 ppm of wastewater, of ammonium coming from wastewater and discharge it to the environment, we go to jail because it's saved by the Clean Water Act. But way oil and gas and wastewater, we are measuring hundreds of ppm of ammonium in streams that coming in Pennsylvania because from those brine treatment facilities that do nothing to those chemicals. So the way to protect the environment is very critical from preventing the disposal of this water, this is the radioactivity that we measure, and the drinking water standard, to give you a reference, is 5. And we see here up to 7,000 picocurie per liter of the level of the radioactivity that we measure in the wastewater. So we're talking about the huge level. And the problem of hydraulic fracturing is the intensity. Because of the reduction of 80% of the gas production, we need to drill. So the concept of drill, baby, drill for hydraulic fracturing is really real. We have to keep the gas production. And therefore, there is a huge intensity and frequency of hydraulic fracturing of wells. And we found that this intensity is also associated with spill. What you can see here, the different, the red color, represent high numbers of well per square mile. And if you see those high frequency of square mile, there are many, many spills. Much more occurrence, much more frequent than areas that without hydraulic fracturing. Maybe it makes sense, common sense, but you just see the numbers and see that it's consistent. So it means that many of those wells, so many of those wells are leaking and so on. So in a place like in Allegheny River in Pennsylvania, we see water coming from a pipe with salinity that is about 5-6 times the salinity of seawater going into the Allegheny River with all the list of chemicals, radioactivity and so on. And that's kind of a model should not be adopted, of course, in North Carolina. So what we do is do we don't want to release it to the environment. We don't want to put it into area unless we sure there's no geological formation that would trigger an earthquake. So treatment is becoming really critical, and we study some of the treatment, and this is the back paper that Dave was finding, and we found that indeed treatment that they use in West in Pennsylvania is not adequate. It doesn't move all of the salt. We found high level of bromide. A few minutes to finish. And those high level of bromide, we argue that even a tiny amount of this high bromide released to the environment, it's increasing the risk of the formation of carcinogenic disinfection byproduct in the downstream user. So I will illustrate that, go into that. So if you are living in the downstream users, and we took those hydraulic fracturing fluid and did simulation in the lab and show that tiny amount of that dilution is not a solution, tiny amount of that would actually increase the formation of disinfection byproduct that we were able to measure in the water. And finally, we also found that the radioactivity, not on the water, in the sediments, of the river sediments in the area of the disposal site, was in a level that exceeding what in the United States is defined as low radioactivity waste disposal site. So all of those areas that you see disposal and or leaks could be associated with radioactivity in the soil and sediments, not only in the water, because of the removal of radium from the water into the sediment. And even if we stop the the disposal, we actually generating a legacy of radioactive disposal site that could be for the next 50,000 years because of the slow decay of radium. The last issue that I would like to address shortly is about water availability. The risk is areas of have water shortage could induce further allocation for water. And this is true mostly for the West, not much in the East. The West, what we see, the chronic water drought that is happening in California and Texas and Colorado, those areas are associated with hydraulic fracturing areas. And Even if the amount of water that we use for hydraulic fracturing is relatively small in a nationwide scale, and we did a calculation, still in a local community that need water, like in Texas, they, for them, it will be another source. Now, it's mentioned that still can use other form instead of water, but I haven't seen a massive transition of that to a place that talk about it, the industry, but until now, they're still using the old-fashioned way of water for doing hydraulic fracturing. And we are starting to do some calculation. We see that there is a big difference here, seeing how much water we take a million gallon per well in different parts of the country. And we see that those with horizontal drilling are taking much more water than those with only vertical wells. So there is a difference between the different formation. What we did, we tried to think about thinking out of the box. And we said, okay, if we don't have enough water, how can we address it? And then we thought, maybe use water that we don't need or give us a lot of trouble. We call it marginal water. And acid mine drainage is one of the examples of marginal water. Water that naturally flowed today because of the legacy of coal, mining in Pennsylvania and West Virginia, there's hundreds of mine that in which acid mine drainage, which is very contaminated with the environment because of the high iron and the high sulfate, causing huge contamination to the environment. So what we say, if we take the bad thing and two things together and mix it, maybe something will come out of it. So we took the acid mine drainage, which has high sulfate, that's why it's acid mine drainage, and with the fracking fluid and mix it together, we did it in the lab, you could actually co-precipitate a secondary mineral and take away the radioactivity from the water as part of a treatment and part of using this water for hydraulic fracturing for the next fracking job. And indeed, in the lab, we showed that 100% of the radioactivity will go away just moving from the water into a small crystal of mineral, which are much easier to handle and to manage. So this, for us, it was a way to be productive, not only to say that thing about fracking, but how can actually use water that we are not using commonly, and we're now doing search for different places, not only acid mine drainage, try to understand how we can use water that saline water, brackish water, to use them for hydraulic fracturing and get some benefit from this process. So in conclusion, what I'm trying to say that our science showing some weakness of hydraulic fracturing. We're not saying ban hydraulic fracturing, we're not saying this is more society decision, it's more political decision rather than scientific decision. But I think we have to, when we are doing it, we have to do it with open eyes and to understand what are the risks associated with it. My experience so far with the industry and with other states have shown that we like not to look with open eyes into the risk and not to address those questions. But I think over long term, it will actually hurt the industry. So I will not go all the issues here. I think before you start fracking, there are many things that can be done. And I think, I'm not sure North Carolina has moved into those states to do those things before going into hydraulic fracturing. And so we kind of having the tools to predict if things going to happen, what's going to happen, and well, still, what does it mean to the people living there? What is many people living downstream from that? So there are different things we can now having a better protection of the environment. And right now, still there is a gap between the decision making and the science and the people in academia. So it's not, unfortunately, it's not together. And finally, I want to thank Duke University for providing us the ability to do the science in spite of some pressure from the industry sometime. And we got receiving funding from the National Science Foundation and from Park Foundation. So thank you for your attention.
out in this audience, and I can tell exactly who came back. It's 100 of you that gave me questions here. So thank you for that. I think we owe another big round of applause to our speakers. And I will say that I can't think of a better way to use a Sunday afternoon, even if the sun is shining outside, because I've learned a lot, and I'm sure that you have as well. It is our policy to take these questions as you've seen them here so that we can begin to go through them. We found that it's very distracting and take much longer if we ask for questions from the floor. We try to be very democratic. I'll try to get to as many as we can. I will ask you distinguished speakers if you'll kind of go through the questions as we can, because we have quite a few and they are good. And if I stumble over your handwriting, please forgive me, but it is a little bit hard to read everyone. So, welcome back. By the way, my name is Linda Staunch. I'm on the Rothamel board, and we are glad that each and every one of you came today. Okay, question number one, and some of these questions are addressed to one or the other. If it does not have a name or I call your name, either one of you may answer. You can kind of feel that for yourselves. First is, if there have been this many years of fracking, why has fracking become such an issue now? What's happened? Have there been accidents, deaths, environmental disasters? Have there been things that could be preventable? Why is it becoming such an issue right now?
It's become an issue because there's a large increase in the production of natural gas in the United States using this technique. Also, the problem you have is that we have to regulate stupid. Many times, if you don't regulate stupid, then people try things they want to cut corners on, they want to just get something because it's like, let's get it done, and that's kind of going to happen. So you have accidents, you have problems, stuff like that. One of the toughest things you face, for example, in Pennsylvania, when you have a truck going down the road, it's beating on the surface road about, for one every one big heavy truck, is about 1,600 equivalent amount of car impacts. So if you have them all then 20 feet apart, they're all going at 40 miles an hour, it's a big dent on the system. If they go to very low speeds, like, you know, let's restrict the speed limit to 20 miles an hour, it increases by a factor of 8 the amount of impact on the road. So if you have everybody go through creeping and creeping through the city for safety purposes, you're actually chewing up the roads even worse. So those are the kind of issues you face with this, where it's been a lot of situations where the increase in production has resulted in a lot of these consequential issues of it being where the roads are getting torn up, the things are getting spilled, let's slow down the traffic to make less spills. It resulted in the roads getting torn up even more.
Okay.
I think it's not really now. It has been for the last 5 years. So I don't see now is more than 5 years ago. The real issues is that because of the nature of the intensity of the hydraulic fracturing, it affects many people life. So so I think kind of the involvement of the numerous number of wells and people living next to them, that kind of led to much more involvement of communities and associated with hydraulic fracturing. I don't think it's right now, it's something, it's a trend that has been for the last 5-7 years.
Okay. This one's a two-part question, and it's pretty specific. I hope I'm going to get the words right. How does 0.5% of the non-natural, I'm not sure of the word, produce such high concentration of toxicity? And number two, if the ground of Earth is a natural purifier, why do we need to be concerned about 0.5% being injected along with 90% of water and 9.5% of sand, if it can be returned to the ground during the fracking process?
When you talk about purifying, earth purifying water and stuff like that, many people think about it being where as the water goes through from the surface down to the groundwater, it goes through a media like a porous sand or something like that. It gets filtered, and the stuff that the contaminants in are filtered out. And Dr. Bengosh can answer much better than I on many of those contaminants cannot be removed, they stay in there. So,
well, I think that, if I understand the question, there are different types of contaminants. There are man-made contaminants. It's the mostly organic stuff that we put into a hydraulic factory. And there's naturally occurring contaminants like radioactivity, ammonium, salinity that is actually related to the nature of the pore water or connate water that's been trapped together with the hydrocarbons within the formation. And when they're coming out, so during the hydraulic fracturing, we open the crack and let the gas and the water, naturally occurring water, the brine, coming out and becoming wasteful. So this natural occurring is actually, in many cases, the source of contamination rather than sink. And then we end up with this wastewater that becoming a problem that what to do with it. Now, if we have a system that we can put it back to deep formation without doing any seismicity, without earthquakes, yes, that's the ideal situation. In fact, in the U.S., 85-something% of the wastewater is rejected back to earth in all states. But those associated with fault system in which earthquakes start to be activated, that then we have a problem.
Okay. Can salt water be used? And if not, why not?
So salt water can be used for next fracking job. The problem is that the industry tried to match the chemicals, the man-made chemicals, with the matrix of the water. So in spite of, they would prefer fresh water if they can. So because the fresh water would not have less impact on the different solubility, the different chemical reaction that takes place with those man-made chemical additives that they're using in hydraulic fracking. In some places like Canada, they're using really saline water, like seawater. But from our observation, in spite of the fact that they're saying, yes, we can, they're still using fresh water. So it's interesting that I've been in this conversation 5 years ago when it started. So yes, we're going to move very fast from water use for fresh water into different saline water, brine. So they have some limitation in doing that. There's some places they're doing more than others. It's a matter of how risky is the industry and the different specific companies in different areas, and how the combination of the chemistry and those chemical additives are living along together. That's kind of the question.
Okay, thank you. Okay, Dr. Taylor, this is for you. How does the commission prepare the water needed for waste disposal to be found, handled, regulated for public health and safety?
The water issue was two things. First thing we put in the rules was you had to have a water management plan. You also had a water management plan composed of two parts. First part is where you get the water from. You have to tell us where you're withdrawing that water to use it to start with. We required that there be a withdrawal of water not greater than 7% or 20% of the 7Q10. 7Q10 is the lowest flow a particular reach of a water, of a river, for example, is in a 7-day period of time in a 10-year period. So 7 days on the lowest flow in 10 years. Okay. So if you have drought conditions, for example, if we were thinking of drought of the severity of like California, you would not be able to withdraw water until the drought ended. Now, for the disposal, all the water that's being disposed of has to be characterized before it goes off site. So then whoever is receiving that has a chemical analysis of concentrations and particulates, or the constituents, for that water, that wastewater going out. So then they'll know whether they can say, yes, I can receive this because my disposal permit allows me to, or no, I cannot receive this. One of the concerns the environmental community has had is that if someone sets up a disposal site on which they're going to take frack water and properly dispose of it by using some kind of desalinization or some other kind of process, that would open up, you could then import it in from other states, from other parts of the country. They could bring it by rail, they could overwhelm the state with all of this other water. Well, that's a federal permit. That's a federal issue, not a state issue.
Okay, this is for you, Dr. Bengosh. Johns Hopkins recently reported elevated radon in the counties of Pennsylvania, where hydrofracking has taken place. Have you ever seen any evidence in your research?
So, in the beginning of the study, we measure also radon in the well that associated with elevated methane with stray gas. We didn't see any correlation. We didn't see high reading in radon. And when you look at this, the new study, they see a rise in radon occurrence in houses in 2004, where hydraulic fracturing started a bit later. So it's kind of still not 100% clear if indeed how it's related directly to hydraulic fracturing. It's really kind of, it's not a causality study, it's kind of a study that's showing that there is some coexistence in time, not entirely. So it's perhaps this one of the studies that opened a new direction to think or to do more investigation to see if there is indeed any a real causality or just kind of coincidence. So at that point, we don't.
And this may be related to that. Again, it references Pennsylvania. How do the environmental issues that fight formation fracking compare to the issues faced in the initial development of the oil industry in Pennsylvania? And do you have any key recommendations for improving the application of fracking and technology in North Carolina?
So just, I mean, one of the things we are facing in our studies in Pennsylvania and Texas and California, Colorado, that we have a legacy of 30, 50 years of conventional oil and gas exploration. And on top of that, now we have hydraulic fracturing. And many of the issues that we related to the past, to the legacy of contamination, now because of the awareness and because of the frequency, people becoming much more aware and linking perhaps processes that happened to the past to things that happen today. So this is a problem. It's not an issue in North Carolina because we don't have this history. But in Pennsylvania, and certainly issues, there are like hundreds of thousands of abandoned wells, for example, oil and gas wells, that they can use the shortcut for contamination to come through it, and it has nothing to do with hydraulic fracturing. So part of our research was to build a tool to be able to do the distinction between the wastewater coming from hydraulic fracturing relative to waste that associated with conventional oil and gas contamination. So we are building those tools. In some cases we'll be able to say this could be either or something to do with the historic legacy. In some cases, when there is a recent spill that we found, and say here, this is a spill, this is coming directly from hydraulic fracturing and not from the historic. But it's certainly a challenge in those places to be able to do this distinction.
Okay. All right, Dr. Taylor, this is for you. Will North Carolina make enough money available so inspectors will be trained, certified, and sworn agents of the state out in the field, even when nothing bad is happening? Could they be on hand to witness drilling and testing of the wells and any fracking treatments of the wells in North Carolina?
The key thing about it is that the General Assembly required that the severance tax be used for the regulatory program. So until the wells aren't being drilled and produced, there's no money. So one of the critical parts about it is that for certain, some of our sister states, they have started with a loan from the General Assembly of that state to basically crank up a regulatory program where they would know that $300,000 or $500,000 to hire the initial staff, train the initial staff, would then be supplemented by and actually replaced by the actual severance tax that is then charged. The key thing we face is that revenue sometimes doesn't stay where they're originally planning to put it, and that becomes an issue with that. A big part about it being is that in our examples from our other sister states, we have personnel, number of wells, number of permits and stuff like that, how many personnel they have, how many field inspectors, how many bench inspectors, that means people that look at the applications when they come in. And it looks to be for basically for every 10 or 15 permits that come in, there needs to be at least one ditch inspector and then approximately 5 to 7 field inspectors. And if you don't maintain that level, you just simply put more and more and more work on the field inspectors or more and more work on the ditch inspectors, stuff slips in and it slips by. And then it's out in the field, you're an inspector, you're a field inspector, and you let them do this. And that's not how they've done them before, but no one caught it. Then it's like, okay, is the field inspector now empowered to say, stop? And our rules and our regulations within our rules that we said is, yes, the field inspector is able to say, stop, time out.
Okay. What's the actual disposal method proposed for North Carolina?
Disposal method is reuse first. The key thing comes down to is that we look at there and see there may be for the chemistry of the water that we have and the chemistry analysis we've done in our state for that at the production depths from Butler and Simpson wells, the two of them I talked about. We're looking at the water could be possibly used 4 or 5 times over.
Okay. This question is about Eastern North Carolina. It's rumored that Eastern North Carolina is targeted for wastewater disposal and deep wells underground. What effect would this have on our water for human consumption, on streams, rivers, and wildlife?
The NEC is on record, Atlantic Energy Commission is on record saying this is a dumb idea. We do not believe that it's proper because the whole thing is that the geology dips toward the coast. So if you're going to drill a hole in and put it in there, it's going to go backing up, upgrade, i.e. further toward the inlet. Okay? And one of the problems you have is right now on some of our aquifers, there's already salt water interfacing. And if all you can do is just put more pressure behind that salt water then rise further up in the basin and cause problems with water resource.
So I have kind of just 2 comments. I mean, when we're talking about regulation and talking about protecting and the numbers of inspectors that I was saying, I think what I'm personally very worried into the future. I've seen what's happened with the coal ash in the history, with the lack of regulation. We've been lacking doing the basic things because we know the waste coming from coal ash is as worse than hydraulic fracturing. And there's the level of metals, and there are right now from those regular outflows that are just coming to the stream, three rivers and lakes in North Carolina. There's no any, because it's exempt from the federal Clean Water Act. Now, after the spill, everybody wakes up and is seeing, oh, we should do that. But in reality, we don't have the regulation, we don't have the enforcement. So if that's the model that North Carolina is going to adopt through hydraulic fracturing, it's, I kind of would worry about the future. And there's this, the fact that I have not heard actually what are the standards that would prevent this water to move from containment, from a pond into the environment. First of all, we don't know. So I think in this uncertainty, we really don't know what is the produced water, what is the quality that's going to come from hydraulic fracturing water at that point of understanding. So we're doing all this regulation, and we think we can do 4-time recycling, but in reality, we have not been extracted water together with hydraulic fracturing during produced water and everything we know happening in Pennsylvania. So we may be lucky that the water coming from the shells in North Carolina will be more cleaner than shells in Pennsylvania and Marcellus. But we really don't know it. That's why this uncertainty for me is kind of a great word.
Okay, also for you, Dr. Bengosh, of the contaminants found near fracked wells, have they been found or proven not to be naturally occurring?
Well, so that 2 points. So there is, when you say contamination, there's surface water contamination and groundwater. In our studies of, as I said, 800, 900 wells, we have not found evidence for contamination of groundwater. from fracking. So we found contamination of gas from a sub-fraction for a small amount of wells. There is evidence, very strongly think, of gas contamination of methane, but not the fluids that coming from fracking. So we have never found those man-made chemicals in people drinking water well. So there is a very less likely probability of getting that. If you talk about surface water, about spills, and about disposal areas, yes, there we did find evidence that this is coming from hydrocarbons. So the question is how you, where you look at it, and how kind of the big pictures. But so if you say fracking itself as it induced contamination, the actual fracturing itself, we haven't seen evidence for that. In fact, one would argue that the stray gas contamination is coming from leaking of the wells, not from the fracking. So if you're a lawyer, you say fracking is safe, nothing happened. But you have to look at a much more holistic approach. The fracking include the well, include the wastewater, and include the management. So you have to see the big picture, how you manage it and how you protect the environment.
Thank you. Dr. Taylor, it was reported that DNR had granted Martin Marietta a permit to dump mine wastewater into Blunt's Creek. Could you address that?
That's outside my area.
Okay. Next question. In North Carolina, who owns the minerals extracted along the lateral line?
The lateral, when you drill out the lateral, you'll have to have someone owning the rights to that, to those minerals. There's two different kinds of minerals. The one kind of minerals is where it's a separate estate or it's a joined estate. If it's a joined estate, it means you own from the surface to the center of the earth. If it is a separate estate, it will depend upon whether that separate estate includes certain kinds of minerals. It might be coal, it might be something else, it might be certain kinds of aggregate and such, but that depends upon how the state was severed. When you have that going out lateral, it has to have everybody in that area has to agree. The mineral rights owners have to all agree that yes, we want to be participating in that. We don't have the ability to have a force pool.
What role, water, does the baseline studies for existing conditions, like with contaminants or methane radioactivity, have in the regulatory permit process in determining the issue of a permit?
Okay, our baseline testing was basically to establish this is what background means. So that if there is an allegation of someone having contaminated groundwater, then we go back to the files and see what was the conditions of that well prior to the drilling nearby. And the key thing about it was if there's been a change in that, and they'll be tested over a several period of years there during production, and that will then be able to show that there's a causality. That's the reason why the water has been contaminated. And it'll be the liability is on the driller or the company to, that's what the baseline is to do, is to protect and the owner.
But the problem is that most of well in North Carolina don't measure for many of the constituents that you can see for contamination. The major elements that you're usually doing for baseline, for normal research, is not sufficient to cover methane. Do we actually, normally we're not measuring methane in our own well. We're not measuring all the chemical on or trace element that will tell you some unique features that are associated with hydraulic, with water that are associated with hydraulic fracturing. So one of the recommendations that we made, that before we're doing any drilling into a site, the state should find the resources to conduct a really comprehensive and detailed baseline study to understand all possible parameters that involve, and that will serve the industry as well, because many of the contaminants, like methane, if there is methane in well, it could be natural occur. So the fact that we are finding methane after fracking doesn't mean that it's coming from the industry because of the hydraulic fracturing. So I think there is a need for a much more comprehensive and much more detailed baseline to being able to do this characterization, and only that the claim for changes would be much more verified rather than just looking at the records, which I don't think, I think what we're going to end up with when people start to have issues, there will be a lot of lawsuits, and some of, most of them probably will be unjustified, but they don't have enough information to verify if it's justified or not. And that would be, the lawyers would be very happy to see.
Okay, what is meant by classification of additive as opposed to the exact chemical content? That's the question.
When I looked at it being that if there is a trade secret, someone says I have a trade secret, there are sometimes, for example, we're in the hometown of Pepsi.
Yes.
Okay, that's a trade secret on what the actual formula is, what to make Pepsi Cola. But people have long ago taken Pepsi Cola bottles, opened them up, and then analyzed them to figure out what's in it that makes it different from Coca-Cola. And this is how they did it. Now, the trade secret is the actual formula. If you can reverse engineering and figure out this, you then have the knockoff colas that are out there by the dozens across the country. The key thing about it is that knowing the general classification, it's caramel flavoring, it's carbonated water, it's real sugar if it's good, it's other words like the high fructose corn syrup, et cetera, which makes up that. And the exact formula is what's the trade secret. So one of the key things about it is when you know the general formula, you then know where the possible contaminants could come from.
Okay. All right. What protections do North Carolina regulations provide a landowner who might hold a full title, including minerals, I guess, on their property, who's not under lease, to assure that horizontal drilling does not enter his land? And also, along with that, would Diener regularly publish location and horizontal extent of drill bores?
When you put in your permit, the first part of it is a drilling unit. That's the way our rules were written. A drilling unit says, I'm going to play in this area. It might be a square, it might be a rectangle, it might be a circle. This is where you as a company have said, I want to play in this area. Everybody inside that area has to have agreed, yes, I want them to play within this area. I'm going in voluntarily into this agreement. Once that then is done and they go before the full commission will then vote, yes, we agree with your request, or the commission has, by authority, they can modify that request. You only get half of that area or something else. And we have procedures and policies, and if you don't like that answer, you can appeal it to the courts. The process then goes next to actually putting in what are you going to actually do for an actual drilling permit. Then it will say exactly how far it goes out. If it goes out right now, our rules say you cannot get any closer than 500 feet away from the edge of your drilling unit. You have to leave a buffer between your horizontal and the end of it. So if someone says, I have a 1,000 foot wide drilling unit that goes out 5,000 feet, you're going to have to back off 500 feet all the way around on that. So that gives them a buffer so you're not stealing minerals, i.e. stealing oil and gas from other people. But also, that buffer's there to prevent there being contamination going off the drilling unit.
Okay, thank you. Shale gas is a finite resource. Once it's completely depleted from the North Carolina site, what then? Is there weakened substrata, possible air and water pollution, depleted fresh water, incurring aquifers? Earthquakes? What then?
So, we are blessed to have coal. So coal in the country is going to be, in terms of resources, for the next 500,000 years. So there's no any shortage for good or for bad in coal. Now, I'm not talking North Carolina, I'm talking about the nation kind of perspective. So many people, when shale gas began, saw it as a bridge to cleaner energy. And in fact, the idea was that the shale gas would be the time to where many of the developments for renewable energy would be becoming much more apparent and much more economic. And now some other people question whether the fact that we have now the oil so cheap and gas so cheap, is that really bringing incentive for development in research and development of alternative energy resources. And apparently if we don't have the sword on our neck, probably we're not going to do that. So that's kind of putting us away in the question whether indeed shale gas is actually indeed a way to prepare us better into our grandchildren's future with respect to renewable energy. And I'm not sure I have the answer to that.
Okay, thank you. Would utilization of the sun's energy with other practical actions like energy efficient programs, conservation, and so on, negate the necessities or risk associated with fracking?
We are releasing Triassic age sunshine. Those plants lived in the Triassic and got buried, and now we're releasing Triassic age sunshine. Okay. That's what we're doing right now. That's what the plan would be. The key thing comes down to it when you look at any of our energy sources and such. One of the fundamental parts about this is what the society wishes to do. In the state of Alabama, as they're doing longwall mining of their coal, they drill in wells to get the coal bed methane out of those coal units 3 to 5 weeks ahead of where the longwall cutters are cutting up the coal. It's actually made the longwall cutting now incredibly safe. There's been a whole lot less explosions and stuff like that underground because they have degassed the coal, and they're using that energy, that coal bed methane, to power things in Alabama. So they now look upon that as something that other states might want to take on to do in other, you know, Kentucky and other of the coal states there.
Okay. And to ask all nine together, how important is the presence of radon in rocks and its release into the environment?
So I'm not sure how important the presence of radon.
Mm-hmm.
So radon is a product of the decay of radioactive element uranium-6, which is part of the uranium decay series. Some rocks contain an elevated level of that and of uranium, and therefore can generate radon, some other less. In North Carolina, there is an issue of radon, and has nothing to do with fracking. If folks living in the Blue Ridge Mountain and also eastern of Riley, they would have areas which are associated with granitic nice rocks, which would have elevated level of radon in well water. Well water is not regulated in the United States, it's not as contaminant, but we conducted some studies on that, and we've shown that elevated radon in the water could result in degassing of the radon from the water into the house when you have household using showers and dishwashers and all the things that would move the degas radon from the water into the ambient house, and if you are inhaling it, you increase the risk for radon. So there is certainly issues. We actually mapped. There's some very good maps of high probability of getting radon. In North Carolina, I think you can say that this area is very low.
Yeah.
You're not worried here, but certainly there's some areas that we can predict by the geology could have a higher risk of radon in both the basement and also in the wash.
And see, one of the things they do with the radiation protection section in the Department of Environmental Health or Health and Human Services, they have mitigation measures where basically your crawl space is sealed up and that the gases that would be coming up in your crawl space are vented out and away from your house and do not get into your house.
the key thing about it is, as Dr. Bengosh was saying, now what are we going to do about your water well? And how are there methods to be able to take the radon out of it, vent it out of your groundwater system, so you do not have that being brought then into your home when you're running your dishwasher or showering, that you prevent that radon from then getting released inside the house because you've already done the measures to keep it from coming up through the basement.
So one of the key bottom line of our study, if you're going to the Blue Ridge Mountain for vacation in a private home, do your showers quickly. Because the longer you stay, the higher accumulation of the daughter isotopes coming from radon, which you could inhale. We actually quantified that. And fast shower would do the trick.
You're all doing great. We're almost finished, but this is for you, Dr. Bengosh. What's your opinion, or do you have an opinion on bottled water?
So there were several studies, not our group, but there are other studies about the quality of bottled water. And first of all, they cost about, I don't know, 20, sometimes 50 times more than your tap water. And if you're living, my philosophy, if you're traveling in Mexico or other places, drink bottled water. That's what I told my student. But if you're living in a community that you trust the utilizers, there's no reason to use bottled water. And in fact, if you go into more deeply, some of the bottled water in the fancy one, those really expensive, are really not good for you. Right. They would contain elevated level of some contaminants. It was shown that, for example, from Eastern Europe, the bottled water that are the one in France that you the same price as a wine would be as contaminant. It would not much exceed the regulation of the EPA for the maximum contaminant level. So if you consume them on a regular basis, you have the money and you're living in France and do that, that actually hurts your, it's not good for you. But if you buy bottled water here, again, we need, on the other hand, we need some of the salt. So if you're buying the whole food distilled water, that's really bad for you. So it's actually not recommended to have water without any salt.
Thank you. Not to mention the disposal of the plastic.
Yes, that's totally it.
Okay, this is not exactly a question, but it's the one I'm going to kind of end on. And I think the question said the question of a drought. I think the question being, are we in danger of a drought in North Carolina?
We have them a lot. There are droughts because of three different reasons. One, there's no rainfall. Okay. Number two is we're using it faster than the rainfall can replace it. That's what happened in 2002. Okay. The third one is where it's like the part everyone talks about a lot of times of being, as this state increases the population and we use it more, it becomes a matter of that it's not a controlled resource. That's why there's a capacity use area in the coastal plain of North Carolina where, because of the depletion of groundwater and the rising of the saltwater interface there, meant that there was a finite length of time before you're going to run out of groundwater in parts of the central, considerable capacity use area in the coastal plain. So there was a fiat made, you will go to different sources in some day in the future, and that day has not gotten here yet, but there may be a great deal of angst by people who live in that area that will then be a matter that you cannot no longer use your well like you thought you could, because the law says you can't.
So just to answer, we know there's many areas of Earth where its aridity has been experienced. Aridity, there is a good correlation between climate change model and a projected drought, like the Middle East, California. So we know that when the temperature, global temperature are rising because of climate change, there is association with higher probability, and we see it, of drought. And actually, there are some evidence in the Middle East and in California, it's actually happening. It's not something projected. But in North Carolina, the models are not as conclusive. So in the Southeast United States, we don't see that tendency of higher warmer, global warming and less precipitation. So That's what it's not as unique and specific like in the West.
Thank you. The final part is actually not a question. It's a request accompanied by a please, and it might be interesting to ask the question of you, the audience, even though it's entirely subjective. The questioner or the card, person on the card writing the card, asks each person to raise their hands in response to, are you in favor of fracking, opposed to it, or undecided? You want to participate?
Sure.
All right. Who is in favor of fracking? Raise your hand. All those opposed to fracking, raise your hand. Those who are undecided. And there you have it. No conclusion. Okay. Thank you very much. I'd like to thank both of you so very much.